Welcome, welcome to House of Reawakening Minds. Thank you for coming out and tuning in to House of Reawakening Minds as we strive to be a holistic center for spiritual grounding, free thought, self-discovery, and more science, an awakening experience for all ages. Please note, the views, opinions, and services expressed or offered by guest lecturers are those of the lecturers and do not necessarily reflect the official policy or position of House of Reawakening Minds. Happy holiday, Moslems. Thank you for coming out and enjoy the lecture for the day.
Islam. Today's lesson is on Zuudiakus, the more about women. Now, keep in mind, Moabite women have been traditionally referred to as Marina, sometimes Zodiac. But Zuudiakus is a name given to the first women, period. So it's not just one woman, it's actually the Moabite women collectively referred to as Zuudiakus. This lesson is an expansion on a short lesson that you'll find registered in the Library of Congress under the Order of the Great Seal, and is issued to people under certificate after mailing to the Library of Congress Copyright Office. And when they receive the certificates are delivered with a cover sheet that they had mailed to the Library of Congress. It will be delivered to a Wali or Qazi of the Order of the Great Seal. At that time, the books and the history would be issued to them. And that was done to mainly protect it from the corruption of the general conditions that you see in our community, because most so-called black leaders are actually COINTELPRO operatives. And to protect it from the corruption of the Christian black codes and the Negro sellout 501c3 community assigned leadership, this information is generally protected by copyright. So they couldn't tamper with it. That's why you wouldn't get this information except by certificate. However, I am the emir of the Great Seal, Order of the Great Seal. I've been that since 1992. And because I noticed that many of our people that are becoming awake were being taken advantage of, Moors who had this information, but who approached it from a financial perspective only, meaning that they came in to the movement to make finance, or looking for a hook to make finance, etc. So, including one Moor who even went through the trouble of trying to change the numbers in the Library of Congress so that people wouldn't have access to this. That was done, I won't name the brother, but he was also a member of the Order of the Great Seal from the land of Nod, which you know as New York. And that brother was expelled from the Order of the Great Seal, etc. And you find out that he was actually working for the Europeans as a security guard. So he was planned. But the deal of it is to counter knowing how serious this information is, I started sharing this information with people so that it would be more broadly spread, because so many people who had this information were very protective of it on one hand, if you understand, because it's by certificate only, but also going to the grave with this information. And so that left a lot of the younger generations void of this information and subject to a lot of the corruption that was ongoing. Meanwhile, the Europeans have been liquidating our people's estates under the Unum Sanctum policy. Part of the Unum Sanctum policy is known throughout the communities now under the word gentrification. So think in the order of Trail of Tears, which continues to this day. And so I started sharing this information, but knowing that, you know, one by one in Canada, because that's basically how it was being presented, that, you know, a lot of our people will be growing up with no access to this information. And then many who had this information were using it from a controlled perspective rather than from a humanitarian liberated perspective. That's why I started sharing this information openly. And, you know, so a lot of people in position of authority, both Europeans and Asiatics, were kind of pissed at Taji Guy. You know, because in your Masonic orders, they paid thousands of dollars for this information. And took in blood oaths of death not to reveal the secrets. And usually they get comfortable jobs in the community. People admire them and never suspect that they have keys to the real history here while promoting the black codes to their own people, family members, and others. So again, I'm sharing this, you know, with you to also let you know what both Europeans and Asiatics know about the real history here. And so today we're sharing Zuudiakus. And Zuudiakus is collectively the Moabite women, ancient Moabite matriarchate. So you must know the order of government on the planet prior to the rulership of the popes of Rome is and was a matriarchy. There was true government is a matriarchy, not a patriarchy. Patriarchy that you see operating on the planet today is totally Roman in its character. And so this is again why women are suppressed in church, mosque, synagogue, and all so-called, and that's an absolute qualification, so-called religious and dogmatic systems. They're really dogma systems. And logically, because woman brings both male and female to the planet, it is key to civilization itself that woman be conscious of herself and of what nativity is, what nationality is, what nationhood is, because it's all related to nativity. And of course, your navel, which is your true birthmark. So the navel and the energies that your mother uses when she's developing the fetus is your real birthmark. And this is where you do the geometric and mathematical math according to the constellations that actually marks the being. And this is the real science at the foundation of true religion, which is cosmology. And then you see the traditional use of the crescent and the star, which is the crescent moon that governs the womb, and it governs the tides, and it governs the blood flow. And then Venus and the moon, you're dealing with fertility and fecundity. And so this is where you have in the ancient world, in the present world, the symbol called Cosmo, which is the crescent and the star. And then you know also that the alchemical metal for the moon is silver, and the alchemical metal for Venus is copper. And so therefore, in symbolism and in culture, the moons, which is dealing with the ecology, agriculture, etc., and economy or the ecology, this is where you get really the term money, moon ecology, moon. Now the Europeans will say money is referencing a Roman goddess. It's a false concept. It's really dealing with the moon, and it's dealing with economy and ecology on Earth, the natural order of things. And so, because ancient culture is based on cosmology, your monetary system is based on gold, which is the alchemical metal for the sun, silver, the alchemical metal for the moon, copper, the alchemical metal for Venus. And this is why your five-pointed star is used traditionally in Asiatic African culture on the planet, universally. And then you're dealing with the symbol of the Great Pyramid, which is also in geometry triangular, or what's called a triad. This is where also the priesthood misrepresent what you call the Trinity factor. You know, they say originally mother, father, son. Then the Romans convert that to father, son. The Holy Ghost is really mother, father, son. Now, and so scholars know this. They keep it from the masses. And the priesthood has become totally corrupt. And while they maintain truth for their personal and selfish selves, they have dogmatically modified the books or changed them out of their original tones and out of their original culture and twisted and flipped them and put them sequentially out of cycle and also eliminated certain books in all of the scriptures in order to put the world in darkness. And the darkness that the priesthood created, they blame on the mystical devil, which is their creation, rather than telling people about the higher self and the lower self and the evolution of the human family. I'm just interjecting that to also reply to you while we're also sharing with you part of the real history. So therefore, we're going to go into Zuudiakus, the Moabite women, ancient Moabite matriarchate. Within the subtitles, you got Zuudiakus, the Moabite women, the secret of Zuudiakus, the age of man-made gods, Morluakin Il, the widow and her sons, the real hell and purgatory, the real heaven, freedom and peace, Islam, and the zodiac. Ancient Moabite Moorish history, the order of Islam, Old Central Omexan, sometimes referred to as Olmec, that's Old Omexan, or Olmec, order of the Great Seal, the North Gate. Now, in all secret societies, from Illuminati to Shriners, Masons, etc., in their orders, they refer to themselves as the keepers of the North Gate. In other words, they were controlling the estate of the world's wealthiest heirs, and that is called the Great Masonic Secret. So the Great Masonic Secret is the body of information that involves the world's wealthiest heirs who are artificially held to poverty under the Spanish Inquisition and under familiars who work for them. And this is the truth of the dynamics of the political platform operating in the Western Hemisphere under the Spanish Inquisition. So again, this information is shared with you to help liberate your mind, because before you can liberate the body and the economics, you must liberate the mind. Because as man thinketh, so shall he be. So I'm going to read a page, and any one of you, if you choose to, can read the next pages, and we can continue. And then we can also ask questions. The ancient Yucatan of Old Central Mexico, Old Mexico, also referred to as Olmec, was the geographical location of the center of governance for the ancient Moabite nation. The Yucatan Peninsula is bordered by the waters that are now known as the Bay of Campeche, and to the northwest, the Gulf of Mexico, to the north by the Caribbean Sea, to the east and by the Pacific Ocean on the western side of the land. As for the ancient earthquake that caused the Atlantis lands to sink and to bring about the great Atlantic Ocean, remember the tectonic plates in the crust of the earth traveling beneath and through the central lands, including the cocoa plates to the west. Often referred to as the ancient ones, quote unquote, the ancient Moabites are the founders of civilization on earth and are the mothers and fathers of the human family. The Moabite nation named women Zuudiakus, from which is derived the names zodiac, zoology, and biology, the sources of evolution on the physical, mental, and spiritual planes of life. In relationship to life, to living, to nature, and to government, the ancient Moabites were guided by the precise studies and applications of the divine workings of nature. Universally organized societies were structured and ruled by astrology, by algebra, by trigonometry, by calculus, and by geometry, etc., as these comprise the science of mathematics. A functional knowledge of and about the universe, cosmos, was and is a cornerstone of the culture. Operative family structure and government were supported by the intellectually established knowledge of the divine workings of nature. Upon veracity and facts, the immutable archaic truths remain that the ancient Moabite nation was scientific, spiritual, and alchemical oriented and had no mystic god doctrine. In fact, the ancient Moabite societies functions in association to and with the divine law of evolution and void of any stifling, suppressing, or stagnating schism doctrines, dogma, as commonly known and practiced in contemporary societies in these days, is diametrically contrary to the nature-grounded matriarchal harmonics rooted in Zuudiakus, the Moabite woman. The secret of Zuudiakus. Zuudiakus, the Moabite women, had taught their male sons or son offsprings the secret of Zuudiakus, being the highly refined sciences and knowledge of the zodiac, the complex workings of nature, of zoology, the science of dealing with the various animal forms, their makeup, their constitutions, biologies, and genetics, etc., and of the broader science of biology being the science of life itself, including but not limited to living matter in all its forms, organisms, and phenomena. These disciplines were furthermore crowned with functional gnosis and Gnostics involving the laws of creation. In due time, after the Moabite women, Zuudiakus crowned their sons with the arcane knowledge of the universe and of creation, the matriarchal character of the nation began to modify and change. For by the transference of the aforesaid arcane Gnostics, it resulted in the loss of their powers of creation and consequently the loss of their control of the world by universal mind in the year 46,000 ancient Moabite. So when you see AM in time now, they'll tell you morning, but it's really ancient Moabite. And this was the era of Atlantis and of Mu, the ancient Yucatan in the Caribbean Sea. With the gradual dissolution of the powerful influences of the ancient matriarchate and therefore of the Moabite nation came the descendant evolution of the Moorish nation. That must be very clear. The Moorish nation is derived from the Moabite nation. It is one and the same. The distinction is that the Moorish nation is more patriarchal than it is matriarchal, but it is the Moabite nation. Now, again, I want to remind you, when you look at the crowning of the sons, or what they call the sons of God, this is where and when you start wearing the fez. It was given to you by your mother. And when you pay attention to the crown of your fez, let me go up here and I'm going to show you some things. You'll see on your fez, and in the secret societies, that's referred to as the tiara or the crown of the sun. It is also tarbush, the fez, the founders of the eternal zodiac. And the fez is the Capitolium of Morocco, etc. Now, you all have this, so I want to show you something that you'll see on the top of your fez. You'll you'll see in four corners, you'll see right in the center, you'll see a finial. And that finial will stick like this, and it'll have a cord. And a ball and tassels. And these tassels represent actually 360 degrees of the Earth dancing around the sun, or actually following a spiral of the sun, actually. So it doesn't so much dance around the sun as it actually follows in a spiral. Like the sun is like not so much of a nuclear fission thing, but actually sort of like mostly actually metal. Gold and silver and stuff like that, different metals. And it's actually going through the greater part of the galaxies of the universe. And so it is the pressure from the atmosphere that actually causes it to glow. And according to the densities, this is where you get the yellow sun to the white sun, according to where it is in the spherules of the universe. And it actually is the Earth and the planets of this particular solar system are actually caught in a conical or conical vacuum. And it's sort of like when you look at your Fez, like from the side, and then also you look at like a pyramid. So you look at the sun, which is also the eye of Allah or the eye of Horus that you see at the top of the pyramid. Look at that as like the sun and that conical, and all of the planets are trailing behind the sun and not actually like a plate really next to each other, but actually in their own orbital planes, sort of like a spring. Like if you look at a stretch spring, and they're actually rolling like this behind the sun. And as over millennia, as the sun, because it occurs over millennia, as the sun burns, you'll have more what you call UV waves or et cetera that actually come around the sun. And this is where you get in different time periods, different what you would call natural catastrophes that occur on the Earth and the different planets where certain energies are allowed to hit it, if you get the whole point, according to where it is in its density. Now, so you will see the strands that come off of that ball, which symbolizes the Earth. And the strands symbolize the degrees of the Earth dancing around the sun in appearance from as you see here. Now, in the top of it, you'll see four corners. And you'll see, if you count the dots, you'll see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Right? You'll see 9 perforations. And you'll see the same thing repeated. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You'll see the same thing repeated in each one of these corners. And then you'll see second holes, and you'll see 12. And you'll see the same thing all the way around. And then you'll see the next one, that'll be 18. I'm not going to try to count this exactly on the outside. I just want to move on. But I want to give you the concept of what you're looking at. Now, so you're looking at the 9 cosmic months of birth in the womb of woman. 9 cosmic months. Or 9 cosmic moons, because month comes from moons. So you're looking at the transits and all the cycles of the moon that govern the womb. So the moon, from the moon comes the month. That's why when women cycle, they would refer to it as monthly. It's really dealing with the transits of the moon. And then the second one, you're dealing with the 12 constellations. And then with the 18, you're dealing with the double nine. So the double nine is your 120 degrees, 120 degrees, 120 degrees, which equals 360 degrees, which equals the circle with the dot, ATC, which equals 100%, which equals a whole, which equals the sun of God. Excuse, this thing is running out of ink. And so this is the dual trine, as above, so below. So you see the Hermetic and the Gnostic philosophies. And this is where you get Hex Alpha, or what is called Solomon's Shield. And so Solomon, or Solomon's Temple, you'll see symbolized as a pyramid with the top part of the pyramid disconnected. What it really represents is your nine with the three missing. And so this is your 9 months in the womb and the other three outside the womb. And of course, now you're dealing with the salts of the earth. So you must understand that on your crown that your mother gave you is the crown of the universe. That's why it's called the crown of the sun. So that's another science lesson of what you wear on. So a lot of people that know that will never tell you that. But yet you'll see all people in secret societies got that crown. Now remember, your mother gave that to you. Now, key is those who know use this to rule. Are we clear? So when you're dealing with people who claim to be Christian, Muslim, Jew, doesn't matter, in their secret societies, they all wear the crown of the sun. They just do it in rituals. And some of the people that are ruling, whether they're Europeans or Asiatics, they'll even have parades in different parts of the country, what they will call a sign for Shriners parades. You'll see all over where they have hospitals and charities, and you'll see the Europeans, Shriners, and you'll see them have the Moorish sword over the Sphinx head, the head of the Sphinx, which symbolizes the subjugation of the Moabite woman. And this has much to do with the traditions in the modern world where women are suppressed, because they're really suppressing the Moabitess. So in suppressing the Moabitess, they're suppressing or subjugating the Moabite nation. And so this is again why a lot of times you'll see them project the idea that they're suppressing males or the sons of the Moabitess when actually she's the target. And also this is why you see in the Christian Black Codes where they have traditionally murdered women or tortured them and forced them to deliver their children under threat to the priesthood in the circle of Rome, which is called the church. And this is where the tradition, when you do the research on Christian Black Codes, where the tradition has its origin in our communities where every Sunday the women would deliver their children to the church under threat. And then, of course, the priesthood would tell them that that's Jesus or God or Allah. You know, it's really the Christian Black Codes and the Unum Sanctum policy. So again, the priesthood is dirty, always has been dirty, but they've never been charged. Again, it's also another reason why that the real history has been, is usually hidden from you, but this is also why it's being shared with you now. And also, if you've ever thought that these so-called leaders and preachers and reverends and imams and rabbis did not know this information, you're the one who's naive. Because they all have this information. They're all PhDs. They all have doctorates. However, they also have death oaths not to reveal the secret. Because, again, as you learn these things, you will lose your naivety. And as you lose your naivety, blind faith has no place in your mind or in your heart. And when blind faith dies amongst the masses, it is actually a sign of their liberation. They may not know it. But anyway, let us continue. So, in due time, after the Moabite women Zuudiakus crowned their sons with the arcane knowledge of the universe and of creation, the matriarchal character of the nation began to modify and change, for by the transference of the foresaid arcane Gnostics, it resulted in the loss of their powers of creation and consequently the loss of their control of the world by universal mind. In the year 46,000 ancient Moabite AM, and this was the era of Atlantis and of Mu, of the ancient Yucatan in the Caribbean Sea. With the gradual dissolution of the powerful influences of the ancient matriarchate, and therefore of the Moabite nation, came the descendant evolution of the Moorish nation. In general, and on the one hand, this transition can be viewed as both the graduation from a matriarchic system of governance, the Moabite nation, and of its daily and emergence into the Moor patriarchal order, being the Moorish nation, and the direct descendants of the Moabite nation. Another aspect of the inevitable consequences via the law of cause and effect, on the other hand, was the gradual evolutionary and social political changes made among the ancient Moabites associated with their highly perfected and involved hybrida experimentation, hybriding. These heterogeneous crossbreeding operations were, as a matter of scientific fact, bound to infuse major changes in the landscape of human life and experience on the earth. As a subject matter within itself, a breed of science, biology, was and is another primal yet suppressed character of human history and development, and a common practical knowledge of the same among the people has been systematically suppressed. The age of man-made gods. The historically acknowledged facts of the existence of feminine images assigned to the ancient concepts of God have never been denied by anthropologists and historians. However, one may note that minimal emphasis has been placed upon the subject. Since the fall of the ancient Moabite nation, which took place in the year 49,000 AM, and which correlates as approximately 2,000 years back in the chronological relationship to the mid-20th century, the once indisputable powers and rulership of the archaic Moabite matriarchy and the feminine deific character of the old world was waning. Then in the due course of that gradual social transmutation came the age of man-made gods. Muanuakanil, the last high priest of the Moabite nation. Now, evolution of man-made gods since the declination of Zuudiakus began with the last high priest, astrologer, metaphysician of the Moabite nation by the name attribute Mornuakanil. It is he who named the creator of the universe Eel. Mornuakanil then gave Yakub the name Israel, and the god Elohim, now Elohim, translated as Elah e Eluah, which translated as Yehovah and Jehovah, and to Adonai, Krishna Day, and to Elah, Allah. The man-made god evolution and derivatives are thus as follows: El, Elohim, Elah, El, Eluah, Yahweh, and Jehovah, Adonai, Krishna Day, Elah, and Allah. Thus, man-made gods have gone through seven stages of evolution since the fall of the Moabite nation in 49,000 AM. The history of the 12 signs of the zodiac reveals that humanity on a global scale has been totally cut off from truth for 400 years. Thus, The history of the 12 signs of the zodiac have revealed the great chain of progress during the past 51,840 years. The man-made God concepts and the related transitions of social powers, rule, and influence were thusly made, originating from the decline and fall of the ancient Moabites, Eel, and all its derivations, by primogeniture to their descendant Moors, M-U-U-R-S/Moors, M-O-O-R-S, down from the Moors by default social and amalgamation introjections to the hybrid Franciscans or the French or the Anglo-Saxons. The widow and her sons. From where the dark-skinned, kinky-haired, thick-lipped, Moabite or Moorish woman comes, no one knows. There is not an animal in the world that has thick lips, kinky hair, and dark skin like her. All of that which can be proven is that she is the mother of male and of female, the human race, who reproduce their kind. She, the Moabite or Moorish woman, is referred to as widow. Please do not take on the wrong perspectives or conceptions with the exposure of these truths, because all females or women are equally mothers and sisters, and all male sons come into being by way of them, the mothers. Therefore, all sons are brothers and sons of a widow. The real hell and purgatory, the mendicant order of Franciscans of the Roman Catholic Circle Church, being the premier contemporary religious power holders, are wielding that power over a massive number of the peoples of earth via their controlling and dominating priesthood bishopric that is rooted in dogma. They possess and have wielded a masterful degree of influence over the masses. Their high priests have expressed through their dogmatic systems the purgatory, that purgatory is a place or a state where the souls of men, women, and children who have died in grace must expiate their sins, and that this purgatory is also a place or condition of expiation of the suffering and of remorse. This foresaid purgatory is representative of a place or a condition whereas and wherein those who allegedly go there shall tend to cleanse or purge and become essentially clean. However, keep in mind that the Franciscan priest brotherhood are secretly well aware of the deliberately hidden truths about the evolution and history of man, and of the undeniable cosmology and Gnostic culture of the earth, i.e. known and preserved through masonry and a plethora of secret societies. The purgatory mysteries must and shall be removed and unveiled in relationship to the erst-promoted dogmata propagations of the priesthood. Symboliographical art. Now, write that down and get used to that word. Symboliographical. Write that down, because it's very important. Symboliographical art, linguistic distortion, and vagity are primal communication tools. Keep that in mind. Symboliographical art, linguistic distortion, and vagity are primal communication tools and are among the varied and powerful social engineering tools utilized by the Roman priesthood. This is revealing to you tools that are used for control, for mind control. Truth need not be told in a multitude of words. And so we will share with you some very elementary truths to facilitate your ongoing processes involving the great humanitarian quest for mental, economic, social, and spiritual liberation. Ignorance of the scientific truth of the works of nature involving the inner nature and a prevailing lack of understanding about the actions and reactions of human beings, as shown in the 12 signs of the zodiac, results in a confused state of mind. Thus, said ignorance, often tainted with and by dogmata, is the true origin of the mental, economic, and social suffering evidenced among the people, which they have referred to as hell. The priesthood or bishopric and clergy of the Roman Catholic Church, via the proclamation of Pope, set forth bulls to punish those who did not conform to the dictates and to the, that's what be, to the commands of the clergy for the benefit of the church. So let me correct that here. And to the commands of the clergy for the benefit of the church. A place of confinement was constructed beneath the exculture chamber, where those who failed to pay tithes and other debts to the church were held as punishment. The formal name for that confinement place was hell. You'll find this right in your Bible. This is again why scholars and people in secret societies do not teach law and history together, because they have trained people that that was a place to go, and they don't know it was actually a jail that was underneath the churches, where they cast people who did not pay tithing and bribes to the priesthood. And this is where the idea of this place beneath the ground, people thinking in the middle of the earth, it was really pits underneath the church where they were thrown and suffered. Many of them were murdered there, etc. And also keep in mind, much of the church's wealth was where they charged women with being witches, would charge them, murder them, and then they would split the spoils between the high priest and the kings of the land under feudal law. And this is, where people keep thinking that the tithing was actually a ruling by God, when it was actually from the priesthood, specifically and more specifically, Pope Sylvester II set up the tithe system. You know, so it's really a tax, a Roman tax. And people think it has a divine order. It came from the church, from the priesthood themselves. But
Islam. Said with regard to the tithe being set up by the Pope
Sylvester II.
It was interesting. It's an old video or audio that's just resurfaced recently of one of the prominent preachers in Valerie is his name, that talks about the tithe and how he had a dream and a vision that what he would do is for anyone that was tithers, when they walked through the doors of the church, there would be some kind of an alarm system that would go off, and it would be really like glorious sounds of hallelujahs and angels singing. But as soon as those that would come through the door that were non-tithers, it would be detected, and that these he basically said that these people would be burned, and he would actually kill them. And this is a preacher saying this. I mean, taking this created, as you say, tax, and using it to his own advantage. You know, we know about him and his antics with the finances and fiat, but just to say, I would kill people if I could that did not tithe. And all the while, he has to know, because of where he is, that this is the tax.
And you see even to this day in different of those houses where the tradition, they know that the people are a little bit more awake than they were. So now they'll use strong guilt trips, you know, mental attacks, making the people think if they didn't tithe, they were robbing God. You know, totally fictitious, but, you know, so they don't murder people the way he did or torture them. So what they use is mental controls. You know, so it's the guilt trip, if you didn't pay tithe, you know, Roman tax, they made people think that you were actually robbing the creator who made you, so you owe this, and that the priesthood is the tax collector for God, since he got direct communication, he was assigned as God's tax collector. So they won't say it like that, they exercise it like that. You know, whereas even as late as the early 1900s, they were still murdering women and stealing their estates for the church. As a matter of fact, when you study history of real estate and real property, they don't usually make references to real property when they're teaching about real estate. So most people, when they think real estate, it never dawns on them that there's another subject matter called real property or about inheritance. And even up to the early 1900s, they were still torturing women and stealing their estates. You know, and the tradition of the descendability principle and the lack thereof has a lot to do what evolved from the Unum Sanctum policy, Bulla, into what is known as the Christian Black Codes that were adopted into the corporate states before they were corporate in 1724 and were vehemently reinforced in 1868 after they closed the Freedmen's Bureau. And of course, the brand system that they set up, which is the Negro, Black, and Colored, you know, this would be demonstrated in the Dred Scott case, the status, etc. And then they started stealing the people's estate by making them wards of the state and non-descendable with the grand system. This has much to do in the nature of the Dungy case that we were looking at earlier. And again, now keep in mind, scholars, sociologists, and anthropologists know this. This is the fundamentals of the operations of the economic system in the Western Hemisphere. That's fact. That is fact. But you will notice that that people that are Asiatic African descent, that are assigned as overseers, will never get into this kind of information. They will talk about racism, you know, because they know that the people can't read, don't know that the race is the human species. It is not a negative. So someone who's racist, it really symbolizes someone who loves the human family or studies the human family. It has nothing to do with attitude. You know, and then the human race is expanded into large families that are called nations that in international communications are referred to as nationalities, and then their relationships with each other in law or having standing in law is the honor of their ancient mothers and fathers, for the inheritances of all people are bound in their hereditaments or their heritage. See the matriarchy, heritage, inheritance. You know, all of this is rooted in the truth of matriarchal principle. And so even when they're doing real research in genealogy, etc., they trace the human family through the mother. And when you're dealing with the politics, they'll talk about the father, when actually the key to really life on the planet is the mother always has been. So those who are in control of the politics of Earth will promote the patriarchy because it's a political platform and it's their political advantage under the Unum Sanctum policy. But in secret, the same priesthood that promote the patriarchy go down into chambers and they actually bow down to what the masses, out of ignorance, you know, and training, call the Black Madonna. She's not the Black Madonna, she's the more whiteness. So in secret, they try to maintain integrity to nature. This has to do with karmic response, because they know the karmic law is that it does not recognize personal station. So what the priests know and what they practice in secret for themselves is not what they teach the masses. So the very priesthood And you see the Vatican, you don't see any women. But when they go down to the chambers, they got a more whitest statue. And they even have a statue of Yahshua. Who is Yahshua? Not Jesus. Oh, that looks like everyday brothers. You get the point. And even though, you know, they've changed the name for, because to protect, in other words, for the dogmatic purposes, this is where they had the Nicene Council, and they called Yahshua Jesus, you know, and these are transliterations, but they're not transliterations in translation, meaning that Jesus is not a translated version of Yahshua. I mean, it doesn't mean the same thing. It has nothing to do with it whatsoever. Or Emmanuel, Emmanuel, if you get the point, which is really who the prophet was, who they used to perpetrate the Constantinian order. So they murdered Yahshua, and then they used him symbolically to win the world's trust, when actually they're his murderers. So this is the whole thing of the Constantinian order that has been key to their successes and their dogmatic control of humanity. So again, this is also why it's important for you to have this world history, except for, what is it?
Yes, Islam. One of the things that I noticed as I was transitioning from Christianity and studying more and the understanding of the science of Islam, but what I've noticed also in the movement, I think some have taken the science of Islam and used it as a substitute for Christianity.
That's reverse church, meaning exactly. That they are misrepresenting it too.
Right.
And this is again why it's important for people to know the real history so they can separate the dogma from the science. As an example, when I was, over the years, I lost track of some of my books. As an example, because I've had my own library since I was 7 and a half, and then we built it up from since then. Now, I have old books from the 1800s with the Bible Tract Society. The Bible Tract Society was set up by a Mason named Charles Rutherford and a few others. And the Bible Tract Society, what you would find is a lot of the Gnostic knowledge and history. The Tract Society was set up as a counter to the dogmatic system that was set up in the Constantinian order. The interesting thing is, and this is why it's important to teach scholarship, the Bible Tract Society of the 1800s became today what is known as Jehovah's Witness. And Jehovah's Witness, as presented today, has nothing to do in harmony with them old books. Them old books from the Bible Tract Society be talking just like we're talking now. And actually condemned the dogmatic systems, which is what one of the reasons it was founded. But it's interesting, whereas people in scholarship know this kind of stuff. But the masses don't have access to books like that anymore, except in rare libraries. Now, if I still had them old Bible Tract Society books, they'd be worth a fortune, which they are now, you know. But most of the time, when you get in the old books and you get past the 1800s and 1700s, the books are so expensive that the average person can't even afford them. You know, as an example, Sister Rashida has one of the books on the Civil War. She used to be a librarian, too. And that book, if you go look up, that book is $3,500 in paper cover. Not the arguments, you know. Not unlike when Stanley Lane Poole's book on the Moors was a common book that basically, you know, was, you know, 5-6 notes, you know, when they started controlling that. For a while, you couldn't even get Stanley Lane Poole's book under $800. Then you've seen Van Servo, before he passed on, did a prelogue in it, and they republished the book. And it became affordable. Then it started, you know, waning again. And, you know, they started charging a lot for that book. Then you also have Ancient and Modern Britons that tells that by David McRitchie, you know, Scottish historian, European. And he tells the history of wars in Europe, you know, and Ancient and Modern Britons, volume one and volume two. It was like 15 and 17. And then that waned out and was at a point that you couldn't even get it. And then you would look on the internet or Amazon, and they would be like a couple hundred nukes for old used copies. Now they're back down again. Yes, yes. And now they're back down again. But, you know, they've done these types of things to keep the knowledge from these people who are tagged Negro, Black, and Colored. Because, you know, again, it's no different than the Dungey case. When you start actually doing research, you'll find, you don't even have to dig that deep. It's just that a lot of literature is not available readily to the people. You know, most of the misconceptions that we have about ourselves and history would be immediately destroyed. You know, this is why it's so important for them to control the narrative and to merge all the papers and things like that. And this is where Weishaupt and the Rockefellers and Rothschilds, you know, hold the position that they don't care, you know, long as they control the private commercial paper, the fiat, they don't care what nation's laws are. And these are the dynamics of the continuation of unum sanctum policies and of the Hyperos, Ku Klux Klan, Knights Templars. Army and Knights of Columbus operations. Again, this is also from a political perspective, you know, why we have secret societies for people who rule, who would get degrees of knowledge. And, like, say, for instance, if you, like, if you're going to a lodge, they'll give you 3 degrees, give you basic 3 degrees, and in it, they'll give you basically an allegorical story, everything, in a principle, and then all other degrees are actually enhancements or expanded learning. However, every additional degree is another oath, and you can't even talk to people that's in a lesser degree. And this is how things have evolved. And people, in general, by not having reference points, you know, can't see through the smoke screen or can't see through the dolphin. But this is, again, why, like, when, if a person is sincere and studying, this is why, and I think you recognize this in your involvement, that, and this goes back even to the statement where people, many people who get Islam, will do a dogmatic flavor and not really just give you the science, because they've been corrupted too. Again, this is also like when Noble Raleigh said, if I could just get you all thinking again, you would free yourselves. You know, because the deal of it is, once you start using your divine mind, you know, you will start thinking universally. And as a safeguard, this is why we see Noble Raleigh made the statement, I am the universal prophet, and my philosophy will be universal. I came to you more as my people because you need me the most, etc. And you'll see a lot of people that deal with the dogmatic operations will avoid that statement. They'll try to act like the Morris Environmental National Movement is a religious organization. Nothing could be further than the truth. We're not talking about things that you all was forced to do to counter the infiltrators that were coming into movement to undermine it under Calvin Coolidge and J.L. So anyway, let's get back to Zuudiakus. And so we will share with you some very elementary truths to
to facilitate your ongoing processes involving the great humanitarian quest for mental, economic, social, and spiritual liberation. Ignorance of the scientific truth of the works of nature, involving the inner nature and a prevailing lack of understanding about the actions and reactions of human beings as shown in the 12 signs of the zodiac results in a confused state of mind. Thus, that said ignorance, often tainted with and by dogmata, is the true origin of the mental, economic, and social suffering evidence among the people which they have referred to as hell. And this is redundant because this is very important for people to know this. The priesthood or bishopric and clergy of the Roman Catholic Church via the proclamation of the Pope set forth bullets to punish those who did not conform to the dictates and to the commands of the clergy for the benefit of the church. A place of confinement was constructed in the exculture chamber. Keep that in mind, exculture chambers. This is also where you get checked from that they're used today, the word check. And when you're dealing with foreclosures, the exculture would be dealing with what you would call the chancery section of the court system under feudal law. So when you see foreclosures, it will be in chancery court. And then when you do the research, that will be traced to a circle church on Fleet Street in England, which is transferred here in North America under feudal operations of the U.S. democracy platform, supplanting and overthrowing the Republic, which is related to the secret treaty of Verona. All these things will be recognized by any scholar. And while I'm not talking about that directly in here, I'm just throwing it out there so that we can understand the politics that people who don't understand these things think what they think is spirituality and the state are separate, and they're actually one and the same. They are two ends of the same stick. Two ends of the same stick. So the exculture chamber, where those who failed to pay tithes and other debts to the church were held as punishment. The formal name for that confinement place was hell, and is even to today. Now, that would be disguised as the Inquisition Revenue Service. Think Thomas de Torquemada. And now that will be presented to you as the IRS. And this is important for you to know the relationships that the different operations of the Inquisition did not stop. They just changed the names and the different corporate operations so that the people would not make the relationship. But keep in mind, people who are sociologists, historians, and scholars, and Masons, Knights Templar, Illuminati, Eastern Stars, Daughters of Isis, Daughters of the American Revolution, Kaikos, Ku Klux Klan, White Familial, Thule Society, all of these people know these fundamentals because they're told them by degrees so that they themselves don't fall for the mind control systems that are beneficiary to them, which are actually economic systems for Roman conquest, having nothing to do with spirituality whatsoever. The real heaven, freedom, and peace. Knowledge of the zodiac is truly a mental and social cleanser, as is a natural purgative against ignorance. For zodiac knowledge gives one a perfect state of mind and reason upon that divine order of nature, namely man's cognizance of the forces of nature which dwell within themselves, man, woman, child, and about them, all of which is referred to as heaven and happiness and peace of mind with oneself. Astrology is the oldest science known to man on the planet Earth. And the word astrology translates as astron, meaning star, and logos, meaning speech or discourse.
Thus, astrology is the discourse involving the cognate readings of and the interpretation of the cause and effect energies, positions, and aspects of the heavenly bodies and of their effects and relationships to man and life on Earth. Consequently, astrology also involves the influences of these heavenly bodies on the affairs of man and of the potential course of the same. Astrological cognition notes the correspondences between celestial observations and the events taking place on the terrestrial plane. This science and discipline is also used to note the correlations of the aspects of the planetary transits as they influence the very aspects of human history, of language, of world views, and of other elements of social culture. Astrology was and is used in calendrial construction and systems, and used to predict seasonal shifts. In the ancient world, astrology was considered a necessary part of scholarly tradition. Astronomy has derivative roots from astrology and the practitioner's knowledge of the celestial cycles. Master astrologers, MA, calculate that the temperament and thus the destiny of every human being manifested in human flesh is principally dependent upon the sign of the zodiac under which she or he is born of his or her mother's womb. Consideration is given to the relationships or the aspects between the planetary positions calculated at the time of the natural birth of the divine being. All of these factors are observed and used to chart, quote unquote, the locations of the sun, of the moon, and of the planets within the 12 signs of the zodiac, and these segments are known as houses. I, self, law, and master, know thyself. And that is the fundamentals of the truth of Zuudiakus, the transits from the feminine or the matriarchy principle into the patriarchal principle, the man-made guide systems without the science. They're not telling you the science. And then you're given the science to make that relationship. Now logically, with your knowledge of this, then you understand the anthropological dispensation that the priesthoods have maintained to give personality to the forces and powers of the transits of the sun, the ecliptic of the sun. And this is where the anthropological presentment of the sun, literally, in Jesus, is the Son of God. In fact, but outside of the anthropological dispensation, it is in fact the physical sun that the planet evolves and spiral and follow through the universe. You know, so this is, again, the priesthood don't want the masses to know the cosmological origin of true religion or even how to use it. And like we talked about past week when we was doing Dr. Nyila's show, you know, tea with Dr. G, where we talk about, you know, the breastplate with the 12 jewels. That's what that actually represents. You know, and of course you can get into the use of colors, sound, tone, for healing, etc. And so all of your own mosque, church, and synagogues and temples, you know, have colored glass. This is where its origin is, dealing with the energies of the universe. Knowingly, and the priesthood knew the sciences. While they knew the sciences, they kept the knowledge from the masses and actually set up systems where they actually made oligarchies out of themselves, and actually the people have been actually serving the priesthood under the guise that they're serving God or the Creator. And this is again why the priesthood started teaching the people that the word God, which is actually contemporary and is Middle English, actually coming down from Old High German, which means to call upon, to invoke, and to pour out. This is where you get your rituals of libation.
It's an act, it's a verb transitive. And it's not a negative, but the concept of the masses who don't know better think that's the name of the creator. It is not. You know, it's a verb transitive, and it actually means good. Coming from the old High German guts, G-U-T and G-U-T-T. All right, and that is derived from their study of the ancient Mauryan dynasty, Gupta, Nanda dynasty, and ancient Sindh, which are around a little bit over 2,000 years ago. The Moabites named it Hindustan. And the Europeans, in the process of changing the maps, call Hindustan India, which it is not. You know, so even when you start studying the geography and the true history and development of what you call religion in the minds of the people today, and this is where you get your Christ degree, when you see Krishna Day, you know, this is where you get Christ from. Or, you know, and scholars know that, and all the priests know that. And they also know that the one that they call Jesus, Yeshua, was actually a Buddhist monk. Even though he was of Moabite blood, he traveled from Lower Asia to Asia Major. So Sindh, what you call India today, it's not really India, it's Sindh, Hindustan, is in Asia Major. And what you call Africa is actually Asia Seoul or Asia South, South Asia. And so this is another area where the priesthood don't want the people to know the real history of the one whom they call Jesus, who is actually a Buddhist monk. You know, and of course, when he reached the, or activated what you call the pineal gland and the medulla, by he takes on the title, and is not the only one, of Christ. So that's an achievement, that's not the person. So now all priests know that, you know, so when they promote to the masses, they tell the masses that Christ was Jesus' name, when actually it's a degree, it's a Buddhist degree, you know, and these are known facts and known factors by the priesthood, period. So again, it's important for you, while it's not directly in this lesson, for you to know these things, because when the naivety in you is slain, you know, when you slay that naivety, you become more liberated, and you can also understand the lessons better that nobody already shared with you. And you'll also understand and comprehend better why certain statements he made, for instance, when he said, "The half has not been told. If I told you everything, you would go back to sleep." Which means the truth, blunt, would be so contrary to what people think or thought it was that they would reject him altogether. So he came to the people with what they thought they knew. So you get the Holy Quran with the lessons of Jesus. Then as soon as you get into the attic chamber, then it turns from Jesus to Yeshua. You know, but a lot of people never even get them degrees, because most of the people get burnt out by the compromised sheiks and grand sheiks who betrayed the prophet. You know, including those who pretend that Duali never taught constitutional principles, or what is called civics, in relationship to the lost estate, to the real politics, you know, of course, and then logically to even understand inheritances and hereditaments, corporal and incorporal, you need to know about the ancient matriarchate in order to understand why the word heritage and inheritance even exist in culture whatsoever, you know, or even hermetic law, the hermetic principles, which are the foundation of the moral and ethical philosophies in all major religions. You know, so again, the synopsis on Zuudiakus, you know, is a good stepping stone to begin to purge yourself of the misconceptions that we have evolved into under the Roman captivity and subjugation and the misprisions created and promoted by the priesthood under Uno Cyclone policy. So were there any other questions in relationship to the people listening?
I have a question. Islam.
Islam.
As you talk about Zuudiakus, the first mother, and her strength and the foundation that was laid as the woman.
Yes, and remember, Zuudiakus is a name given to the women collectively.
Yes.
And so they'll say the name of the first woman, a woman, but it's really the more vitus collectively, yeah, or Molinos. And another name they would generally call the Asiatic woman is Molina.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Continue. And as the woman has basically fallen, and we come upon this age of transitioning where I would say, you know, there's a time for an awakening is upon us.
Yes.
But we have, this is a lesson that is geared towards the woman, the
yes,
women.
To her rise.
To her rise. And I know you're going to get into that. What is disheartening is where you have the so-called conscious woman and you have the unconscious woman.
Remember, and this is with due respect.
Yes.
The word conscious and unconscious is thrown down around too loosely.
Exactly.
Not unlike the word love being thrown around too
loosely.
That's
what I was going to get to.
It comes in, yes. It comes in degrees. As an example, with all due respect, you'll hear a lot of people talking on like YouTube and Facebook and different venues of communication talk about conscious community, as an example. Whereas a scholar knows that that's in degrees. And when you're dealing with the truth of civilization, the first rule in the truth of civilization is man, know thyself.
Yes,
and so anyone who's called conscious, that calls these people black, is not conscious. I don't care what other data they may present. Now, because it's so sensitive, a lot of people don't charge them or call them on it. But another scholar or another master mason, you know, in their knowledge base, automatically knows that that person is compromised. Now, a person who's less exposed to this kind of knowledge don't know to make that measurement. So again, like I say to you, when people say conscious and
unconscious,
yeah, it's kind of
that's what I was getting to. The conscious, so called,
it's too loosely thrown around.
Loose. Because what I was getting at is that we have the so called conscious, and we have the they call so called unconscious. But however, the women love principle is missing in the ability to be able to rise up and take their position.
Now, look at this. With the Christian Black Codes, the enforcement of the Christian Black Codes, women being the target, and for so many generations being forced to deliver their sons and daughters to the bishopric, even to today, right, when you look at the Virginia codes, Connecticut codes, and all the different codes of all the corporate operators of the corporate state, you'll see the directives that are practiced to this very day. And so women must be aware of what happened to us in order to understand the root of her unconsciousness.
Yes, ma'am.
And she
not by herself, but logically with her sons, who both been deceived. But the key to the liberation of humanity has to come from the woman, as she is the gateway for both male and female. It appears in some ways to be an unfair burden, and in some ways it is, because by default of nature, woman is a governor. She easily takes on that role when she's running the house or anything in general, even society. A lot of times when you really study social operations, women pretty much run everything. However, they're not credited for what they do. And I think because the social operations are like that, a lot of women don't recognize or don't acknowledge their power. There's a psychology, not a reality, a psychology of her being disarmed, if you get the point. And so she often, by the training of dogmatic systems, look for her sons, us, to produce certain things in our relationship that we, as sons, actually have no power to do. You know, we have start having false expectations. Now, the son is, by his nature of his structure, a protector, and to some degree, a provider. However, in the real operations of governing things, it is natural for women to govern things. For instance, like, you know, talking as a man, as a son, I'm capable of a lot of things. I mean, I have a lot of multiple skill level. But I already know from the reality of things, like say, I can build a house, but a woman could run it better. I ain't gonna run it. I can build and make it beautiful. I ain't gonna run it like a woman do, and I ain't gonna take care of it like a woman do, but yet I can make it where it's, or men have a tendency, it's only where they are in their mind. But most men, things that we do, consciously and unconsciously, we do for a woman, whether it's someone we meet, we marry, someone we're trying to attract, our mothers, our sisters, our aunts, we operate that way, unless there's some political or artificial interruption that causes us to think or act other than that. The natural order of man to do is he's always trying to impress women. We're not talking about what men admit to, we're talking about how nature works. Now also the nature of operations is also where, as an example, look in society, whether you're dealing with government structure, you're dealing with housekeeping, you're dealing with schools, hospitals, all institutions, look who really runs them, who does the real work. If you look at hospitals, it's not taking discrediting what, you know, some sons do. If you go to any hospitals, it's the women that be curing people. Them nurses is the ones that really doing the work, that pull people through in spite of what doctors do. And many of these nurses know more than these doctors, they just ain't getting paid. You know, they get the degrees if they, you know, go for RN and registered nurse and all that kind of stuff. But it doesn't mean they don't know the skills before they get their degrees. You go to schools, 90% of your skilled teachers are women. Doesn't mean that the males don't have those abilities. We're talking about when you study how nature really works. I mean, the natural flow of things. It doesn't put us out, but it's in the women's nature to govern. But it's not in the thought patterns based on the politics. Dr. Nayo?
Islam. In that same vein, every time you mention that, it makes me think of Proverbs 31. And I'm reading, if I can share this, from the NIV. Most people would know it. It says, in this version, a wife of noble character who can find, she is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it's still dark. She provides food for her family and portions for her servant girls. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hand to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all.
Exactly. Now, that is an acknowledgement without, in other areas, it being exemplified in these houses, but is really reflecting the very nature of the matriarchy. It is women's nature to do that. Now, because of the politics, and under the Christian Black codes where men and women have been pitted against each other or to compete, which is really where we are in the culture today, which is the root of many of our personal relationship problems. And by the dogmatic systems that women have adopted under the priesthood, thinking it is religion, which is one of the mind control systems where a lot of women today actually run their men away. And, you know, and a lot of people don't really understand this because half the males think that they run in the house type thing. You know what I mean? Because we train that way. So there is no balance or harmonics in relationship. Then the other deal is the natural power of womanhood when it's negated, meaning that when she's living in her lower self, instead of being the widow God principle, she becomes the black widow, and she actually destroys the men, which is part of what our problems are today, that many people don't have the guts or the honor or integrity to really discuss openly. But yet, the damage that that dead culture has done in our community is evident throughout the community. And yet, most people will never honestly discuss it because it's ugly. Men and women feel victimized and are insecure and are very dishonest about these affairs. But when you look at these dynamics of our relationships, the real deal is that we're out of harmony with nature and have not admitted it. And we have adopted dogma in the name of religion that has absolutely nothing to do with spirituality or true history, and have lost our state and our birthright, and the Europeans have been feeding on us and pumping dogma at us with the help of people that look like us who are really overseers and themselves have degrees in secret societies, got a Moorish fez, know that root of all violence, because one of the lessons they give in all secret societies across the world is root of all violence. And you'll find a book in the Bible called Root. When you go do the real research on Root, it's Yahshua's great-great-grandmother, and Yahshua, they renamed as Jesus. And she is a symbol of the strength of women on the earth. That's why they call people who have no compassion ruthless. She is representative of character and also representative of this of the allegorical story of woman coming into her right mind and calling for the restoration and salvation of the nation. Beautiful.
Also, there is another scripture, and I've preached this when I was preaching back in the day, from Numbers 27, which deals with the daughters of Zelophehad, which I, when I preached it, I called it, give the daughters their inheritance. I think you've probably even heard
that. Can you share that with us?
Well, these were five daughters whose father had was deceased, and the custom was that if there were no sons to pass on the inheritance, daughters couldn't get the inheritance, and then I guess they would just take the land and give it to whoever the nearest relative was, but the daughters couldn't, sons could. And these five daughters went, according to the story, went to Moses and had the, you know, had their meeting of, you know, stated their case, you know, because our father died in his mess, basically. They said there's no reason why we should be deny our inheritance, and as a result of them coming forward on this, it changed the precedent.
And moral and ethical argument.
Right, it changed the precedent that if a man died and had no sons but had daughters, that the inheritance could in fact then be passed on to the daughters, and if there were no sons nor daughters, then it would be distributed to the closest relative. But these daughters, these women, had to fight for, they had to speak up and say, listen, we are entitled. And that's the same thing, you know, now, you know, in the state that we're in, we don't know what we're entitled to and what we're capable of.
Now, this is back to understanding hereditaments, both corporal and incorporeal. Even the word inheritance, even in the word heritage, even in divine law and the studies of the phenomena of the workings of nature called hermetic law or the hermetic principles, the seven hermetic principles. The deal of it is people need to recognize that that status, even as you speak of in Septuagint and Bible, are contemporary. They are not the ancient world. And a lot of people look at the Bible as being representative of the ancient world, when actually that's contemporary history. Because even when you study it, even when you listen to certain things where it talk more specifically about the feminine, you can see in the nature of the conversation that the power that is in the nature of women's actions, her activities, etc., the very nature of her being, including, we'll get you in a minute, including the fact of when you look at the genetics, when you look at even, like say, in the nature of birthright and inheritances, demonstrated in the book of Genesis, chapter 25, when you're dealing with Esau and Jacob and Isaac and Rebekah, you know, and Isaac being blind and Rebekah deceiving him, etc. But when you go into the ancient history, pre-patriarchal, it's all feminine. Even when you go into ancient Asia and Africa, all around the world, and you look at the old civil temples, where today many of your old and ancient mosques, synagogues, and churches are built on ruins of ancient civil temples, and they were all female. When you study human evolution on the planet, all of your ancient deities were feminine, all of them. You know, so none of this stuff is really mysterious when you just start looking at the evidence. And I think a lot of times, and I, you know, it's not logical, but when you really study human development, a lot of times we measure what we think history is by the state of mind that we're in today. You know, so they'll look at ancient history with a patriarchal mind. When you start looking at the archaic evidence,
it's not supported by the evidence, because all of your ancient gods are females. So even the whole concept of, like, I was talking to a brother and sister today, earlier today, when I was having coffee around 52nd Street, and they were talking about Trump, the Bible, God, all, you know, about people surround, talking about stuff like that. And we were talking about the ancient matriarchy indirectly, not as a subject matter. And all of your concepts that people have, just like you'll see most people in church, mosque, or synagogue will accept that the word Elohim is accepted universally as God. And yet, the scholars, the imams, the rabbis, and the priesthood will never tell the masses that Elohim is a plural. And it means, in fact, mother, father. It does not mean male God with a turban on, sitting on a golden throne in a cloud. It means mother, father. Not unlike when you go into the history and evolution of humanity on the planet, where when you look at the ancient script and it will talk about, you know, man's sojourn here, and including the other worlds, or the other peoples of other worlds even coming here to the planet and even dealing with the genetic hybrid, and they'll say, let us, plural, make man in our image. And the priesthood will turn around and speak of the God principle in singular form, you know, and always give it a masculine flavor. And the real deal is that is contemporary. And the books really don't even truly support it, except where they altered the books out of their original formats. And you'll see, even when you do research, even up into the early 1800s, they have admittedly, over 136 translations of the Bible, and then you have over 5,000 subdivisional transliterations of them. And even where they have removed, like, say, for instance, you'll find in the early 1700s, 1600s, and stuff like that, where the scholarly presentment of the first Bibles, in which was even taught in the churches, Enoch, and other books in the Bible that are removed today. But yet the priesthood and the scholars are well aware of the alterations and the modifications, and they themselves do not maintain the concepts that they institutionally promote on the believers in the churches, mosques, and synagogues. And again, this is has much to do why it's necessary to groom the people into studying the ancient history, and so putting things in context so their concepts will be correct, so their concepts will be corrected, and to give them a platform of mental liberation. He passed the mic to the brother here. He wants to present a question. Push the button
off. Yeah. Oh yeah, I wanted to ask, the stars that's on people's homes, that symbolism. You ever pass by houses?
So you have the star of Venus, and sometimes representing Jupiter.
Okay. Now doesn't represent any kind of masonry or nothing.
Well, masonry is actually mother and son.
Yeah.
See, so this is what you must also understand. Now, as far as social engineering is concerned, the general masses will be given a negative idea of what masonry is to keep them away from it. But masonry in its fraternal order, masonry in its historical order, is actually the preservation of the history and the science and the culture of the human family.
Exactly. All right. Yes. I was facing the Vikings to a home last night. I'm on the bar right here. So.
Stay on you.
I'm a barber and I cut hair, so I'm
I'm a barber too.
Oh, okay.
My family's barbers.
Oh, that's beautiful. I've 20 years at it, so.
Yeah.
And I went to his home, you know, he wears a necklace and everything, represents it. So when I go to his house, you know, I said, so I always see it when I'm on the road, you know, but he never talked. You know what I am. He never talks to me. His wife questions me, he never talks to me about it.
Yeah,
I know for years. Never.
He's bound by oath.
Oh, I know that. I don't ever bring it up. I never even speak about it. And he knows that I am. But it's funny that just last night, his wife was asking me, he was walking off the whole time, but at the end of the day, none of that discussed. And I know that that star does mean the sun, you said, right?
The star. Now, which star are you talking about?
The star
Hex Alpha? Or you talk about the star of Venus, the 5-point or 6-point?
The 5-point. I think it's a 5-point. Yeah.
So a 5-point. Now, eastern star, the 5-point, will be upside down, and it'll have Ruth and the other great women in that star.
Mm.
And then have the different colors, except that now it'll be used in eastern star.
Mm.
In eastern star, I'm building vices. But according to the fraternal orders, they will have a Masonic brother who runs the lodge, even though it's feminine. So you still got to remember the patriarchal system that has been set up by the priesthood, that actually in its nature is still corrupted. However, the reality is that masonry in its fraternal order is really codified Islam.
Yes,
codified Islam. You know, however, they're also given in such a way that that is not immediately shown, even though if you go into any Masonic regalia place where the regalia is sold or ordered, it's very clear that it's Islam. You know, and not unlike the reality of the dynamics, you know, here's some guy, you cut his hair, and you notice that he's even silent, and this is the woman that he sleeps with.
Yeah.
Now, keep in mind, now, this is your culture, whereas he may hide it, you're supposed to speak freely.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're not bound to the bond.
Yeah.
You know, and when someone asks you, then they're open to receive and tell the truth.
Yeah.
Drop it like it's hot.
I would consider him rocking a boat because he speaks.
Drop it like it's
hot. If he speaks, he's rocking a boat. But I freely speak, but sometimes I keep my limits because he get a little uneasy and uncomfortable when I start speaking certain things.
Yeah.
That's that
whole
talk. Oh yeah. So I know he can't discuss what he's.
He's under bound, bond, rep, etc., and he's paying thousands of notes for them degrees, and every degree that he stepped, he took another oath. You are, you didn't walk into more science, and within months, you're past 33.
He's Spanish, and she's a sister.
You know what I mean?
So
either way,
I'm giving her her.
Because we know, now remember, ain't no such thing as Spanish. That's a cover of Moorish history.
And he knows that. He knows that.
Yes,
so,
he knows it.
Like I said, I keep my boundaries because it gets a little itchy when I start.
Of course.
I don't really speak. See,
this is the deal. The way things have been set up here, a lot of sons are threatened.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because the knowledge that would empower women, see, because there's two things that can take place. She, in her higher self, can become a great asset and supporter for him. But if she is in a victim mentality, she'll use that knowledge and destroy him.
Exactly.
See, so they're afraid. Women have been abused under the Christian black codes.
Oh, yeah.
But the abuse is really the entire nation.
Yeah. Wow.
But our concepts based on dogmata is separating ourselves from women, meaning that women's issues, men's issues.
That's Christian dogma. That's not Asiatic culture.
Okay.
You know, Asiatic culture is meaning that, like, if we're brothers, right? Right? Your children is considered my children, and my children is considered your children. Meaning that when you hear the old term in Asian culture where it says it takes a whole village to raise a child. So it is common in Asiatic culture before we fell to the Christian dogma or the Constantinian order psychology, where we didn't consider other people's children not our responsibility. Meaning that, and many of you, maybe many of you haven't experienced it, you know, because of your age. But when I was young, it was no big deal where when we came home from school, we stopped at Aunt Burke's house or anybody in the block and ate if mom wasn't home, and vice versa. The children in the neighborhood ate wherever they were and were disciplined wherever they were. Now it is totally, totally different because the culture has finally been wrung out of us. You know, so there's little compassion anymore. As a matter of fact, the state has claimed the bodies of the children, so you can't even the parents are scared to even discipline their children because the corporate state has claimed the bodies under the unum sanctum and has been legislated. It's still colored, but it's been legislated into the operations. And this is again why it's important for people to know the real history, and we must get back to that in order to solve our economic and political problems. You know, again, when people know the history, it is, you know, it gets out of that psychology of it's an idea that somebody came up with. They begin to recognize the dogma that they've accepted is totally fraudulent, totally fraudulent. And you don't actually have to dig back that far. You know, you can go back, you know, say 125 years ago. But again, you know, people's concepts about everything in these last 100 years or since the Whigamore Party has been really skewed. This is again when we were just having our earlier conversation when we went into the Dungy case to show you that this is contemporary history, whereas the concepts that people have are totally corrupted and they're not aware of it. However, scholars are aware of it, and it's easy for them to fix this. Their willingness not to fix this is evidence of their compromission, not their lack of knowledge. You know, and people who don't know this think they just lack the information. Not true. They're compromised. Was there the other questions, Tam?
I was looking at, you mentioned about the Eastern Star and the different stories. Like you have the yellow is the story of Ruth, story of Esther.
Yes.
Story of Martha. Story of Electa.
Yeah.
And story of Ada, A-B-A-H.
Yes. Now, what occurs when you start doing the research, you start finding principles of character and character building, etc. And you'll find that the tools, like are used in masonry, also in the Circle 7, 5th chapter, the workshop of the mind. And so with the masses, they've been trained into worship. But those who know better know us workshop of the mind. In the ancient world, we didn't worship anything. We studied the universe. And true religion is based on a knowledge of the workings of nature and character building, the workshop of the mind. So the same priesthood who've been pumping to the masses worship in truth themselves don't entertain that. They do that as a front, but they got their hands in these people's pockets. And then when, this is why a lot of them, when people who know this speak openly, they get uncomfortable. Because they are found guilty. But was it continuation? All right. Now, so here is the sign of the zodiac, dealing with Pisces, Aries, Taurus, Gemini, Cancer, Leo, Virgo, Libra, Scorpio, Sagittarius, Capricorn, Aquarius. And you see your north point, south point, Now you see your north point, east point, west point. So this is where you get north, east, west, and of course south. Let me try to bring that into view. Try to balance that out for you. But anyway, this is where you get news, the tradition that you call news. And this is where the priesthood would study the ephemerides. And ephemerides, you get a reading of the heavens. When you say the wise men follow the stars, you get a reading of the heavens, whether you're dealing with the living man or woman, or even geographical. So when you're doing an astrological chart, they may do a chart on people, on areas, on territories, on geography, because it all involves all of that. And this is the origin of the news. So even the origins of a lot of things that people assume to be one thing actually have another origin. And the people who know this, i.e. the priesthood, have kept that from the masses for their selfish selves. And so a lot of the misunderstandings and the evil hatred, the self-righteousness, the competitive mind mentality that people practice, it comes from the devil. It came from the very priesthood that the people have trusted. And so the problems of the planet has much to do with the priesthood, not the mystical devil. And the secret societies are there to keep them purged or baptized from the dirt that they have perpetrated against the earth and the inhabitants of the earth. And this is symbolized where you see Yahshua, even at the age of 12, disputing with the doctors of the law. And with the priesthood delivering Yahshua to Pontius Pilate. In other words, these are symbols or stories, allegorical, that it has always been the priesthood that has murdered the prophets or facilitated the murder of the prophets. And the mystical devil has always been a tool used by the priesthood to hide their own guilt. And this is again why when you start getting into the archaic knowledge, people who know the truth get uncomfortable. Because the images that they have with a lot of people around them is a false image. Meanwhile, they paid, you know, like somebody, you come in here and we, like, if somebody come here for a little while, we take them past 33 degrees in short order. We give them, without mystical stories, you know, information that if they're wise, if they're diligent, take them far beyond what they want to get in any lodge, without all the mystical.
That's why they're lying.
Oh, yeah? But the ugly thing is that these people that they trusted knew this information all the time. So the zodiac is a band of the celestial spirits standing about 8 degrees on either side of the ecliptic that represent the path of the principal planets, the path of the moon, and the path of the sun. In astrology, this celestial band is divided into 12 equal parts called signs, and each being 30 degrees wide and bearing the name of the constellation for which it was originally named, but with which
it no longer coincides, owing to the precession of the equinoxes. The zodiac is also a diagram or figure representing the foresaid. Astrology conjoined with the zodiac rests at the center of ancient and modern civilization and culture on Earth. The geometry of cities, their designs, and architectural layouts, and that's called metrology. Understand that's how all the cities on Earth are laid out by what is called metrology. Or that's a study of the universe, and everything is balanced on the star on the planet. So all your major cities are laid out by metrology. That's just an interjection. Yes. And the structures of buildings around the world are drafted, planned, and built accordingly. Therefore, and with certainty, this final science reflecting the workings of nature is rooted within all aspects of ancient Moabite Moorish traditions and customs by inheritance. These keys have been passed down to us in the present. We can observe that astrology is irrefutably a fundamental part of and indelibly associated with Moabite Moor science. Peace. And so that's the end of Zuudiakus. Yes. Now, one of the other things I want to take in this moment that we're discussing is I also looked at, I went over papers that you had sent. The major thing, and remember this, and also make sure this is addressed to everybody that's going with us. The flaw, the general issue is correct. Write this down and don't forget it. Do not name the corporate entity without having the living man or woman's name in front of it. Meaning that don't say such and such bank. That I'm telling you, everywhere you had the word you, remove. Name the person. So I have notified you, I have notified Joe Smith or Joe Velasquez at such and such a time with such and such an instrument.
No pronoun.
Always name a woman or man. If you're talking about an operation of a bank, name the CEO of the bank, and you can also include the name of the person that sent correspondence to you. But at every time that you name the corporate entity and not the living, you just put a mask on them again. This is one of the tricks that the barristers have always used to hide their responsibility from obligation, to get you to start speaking to the dead, because they've also declared you dead under the form of sanctum, which is why when they're making communications, they will do the all capital letters. All right, so keep that in mind. So always say, as an example, Horace Greeley doing business as Wells Fargo.
Right.
All right. And then in the context of your talking, always say, you might say you, say Horace Greeley, except Joe Smith, etc. Also, remember this too, this is very important. Up here and put this up here. In order for them to steal from you, and this is not unlike the same principle of them substituting dogma for religion, this is also to support the unum sanctum, right? So the political platform, correct, that was set up by the Moors and some of the deists. Now the deists are referred to as John Adams, Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, who were referred to as the alleged founding fathers of the political operations at North America
between the Moors and the European suns. All right? They are deists, they're not Christians. They're deists. All right? So you have the Republic. Versus the democracy. Right? So this is legitimate. Ill legitimate. Right? Is your de facto proper improper? Republics or Commonwealth right versus states of. Clear. Now, like for Delaware as an example, when it's written, right, it would be right. Here we have EL or DEL like that. Right?
D-E.
Right.
D-E.
D-E, pardon me. Right?
State of
the now, this would be aggregate land. This would be so when you write DE or this in your mailing to you, you're in the middle of the sea. These are two different jurisdictions. Now, you need to know that when you're talking about your estate or your rights or constitutional principles, you don't put that in your address. You come under the seal, the holy seal, that's the Pope of Rome, and they declare you dead at sea until proven otherwise. That's unum sanctum policy. So when we're writing writs, you must be cognizant of that because you can't serve two masters, meaning that they will use it against you. So, again, it's kind of difficult, so we have to make people aware of these things. Just like, you know, everything can be taught at one time, but you must, and this is again why a couple weeks ago we did the issue, or went over again the issue of jurisdiction, understanding that people's concepts, they do not understand jurisdiction. jurisdiction involves everything you do in life, every day of your life, in all economic, social, and political activities. And jurisdiction has not been taught properly to our people. And due to the fact, when you, this again, when when you're talking about, you know, consciousness. So when people are conscious, number one, they know themselves, they have a general foundation of the real politics, they know how we got to where we are today, they know the truth about religion and general knowledge of the true culture. And if that's not at the foundation of their consciousness, and then you talk about their consciousness, that it doesn't apply to such persons. You know, and so, again, even that comes in degrees. But when somebody's talking about their conscience and that's not rooted in them, don't dirty the word by calling them conscious. And don't dirty the word by calling them scholars. Because remember this, not unlike the requirement of any teacher, which means like if you have a teacher, and a teacher's teaching children, right? And they're getting paid for it, right? And the teacher tells the children about Black history and presents that as a pedigree or bloodline. That teacher is unqualified or compromised, and there is no excuse for that teacher either. Are we clear? The fact that they're compromised under the General Education Board is a fact. But from an educational point, that person is unqualified to be messing with anybody's children. Anybody's children. However, a scholar would recognize that, but a non-scholar would not, if you get the point. So when you're talking about consciousness, again, it still involves that. So when you're talking about political jurisdictions, and you're talking about rights, you know, you can't, you must be aware of this because you can't mix these two arguments in a writ when we're talking about estates. Because this was created to steal your estate. That's why that was done. This was done politically, deliberately, as a cover-up of this, which was overthrown. And this is where you have also what is known as the Act of Congress 1871, the Organic Act of Congress, where in order to enforce the Uno Sanctum policy, they did a coup d'etat and overthrew the Lincoln administration. That's why all scholars know that the Lincoln administration was the last legitimate government under the Constitution. After Lincoln, there's no lawful administrative governments operating at North America. And the people of the Republic, who are really descendants of the Moors, now branded Negro, Black, and Colored, are also disqualified. You see, so not only does this need to be corrected, but the heirs to the estate, who are really the Republic, that don't know they're the Republic, need to be made conscious and acting accordingly. You heard Mike.
Should that be aggregate as in together or no?
And of course, that is the physical land. And keep in mind, this is where you get the real and the corpse, or corporate. And see, so this is again why they do the attribute in all capitals, so that as far as natural law is concerned, they avoid the karmic debt, because even in the dark priesthood, they have a code of ethics, which means they will tell you what they're going to do to you. But this is to preserve them or play safe from the karmic response that does not recognize personal station. This is why they're referred to as the great deceiver, meaning they deceive people. This is why miseducation plays such an important part in social engineering in the Western Hemisphere under the Spanish Inquisition. This is why the Romans burnt books and hid books and altered books, and why they have secret societies. You know, so what happens is we actually violate divine law, thinking that beliefs equal knowledge. So belief systems are presented to the masses as knowledge. It is not. It has nothing to do with knowledge whatsoever. It has everything to do with mind control. And this is where you have religion, which is the science of the universe, and dogma, which is what the masses get. Now, these factors are known by people in positions of authority. They're told this. This is what their degrees are. Meaning that they're literally told this. It's not secret. But they're also bound by oath. And so this is how they create the hierarchy of inquisition operations. And so even like when we're talking, say, basic grammar, grammatication, you will see, as an example, the grand systems that were set up by the German Dutch masters in the Western Hemisphere, you know, the Negro Black Colored Indian game, etc. Anybody can go to a third grade elementary school dictionary and see that black is Middle English and it's an adjective. So a child third grade who can read, they ain't saying the parents know how to read, we're talking about children, that look and see the word black as an adjective, know that it's not a person, place, thing, or idea, because that would be a noun. But yet, in short order, that child will be smokescreened, and within just a couple of grades, they can't read anymore. You know, and then the parents tell them that black is an African identity. And scholars write books saying that black is an African identity. And yet, in the same dictionary, it will show you the morphology of the word, and right beneath black, you'll have a compound word that says black dot a dot more. And if more will be capitalized, the black will be all even case, then they'll say noun, then they'll separate the adjective from the proper noun, capitalize more, say any dark-skinned woman, man, or child.
It's another new dictionary.
Yeah, huh?
None of
the
dictionaries got that.
All
older.
No, you get your older dictionaries. I can pull any one of these dictionaries. Sure.
Oh, I never could find
them. But your contemporary, this is why your older books mean that as soon as you get in, usually past 1960.
Yeah, well, I got 50.
Yeah.
Have 50.
And you want to stay away from soft covers.
Oh, yeah.
Or edited. You want to deal with unabridged dictionaries. And this is again why they get rid of the old dictionaries, because logically, particularly dictionaries on the etymology of the English language, etc., will simply take you right to it. It's not even hidden. You can grab one of the dictionaries, even off that shelf, and you can see just what I'm telling you in either one of them. You know, it's not hidden. However, and this is the point. Yes, you can grab the first one right there, even that red one. Yes, and even give them the red one there, same thing. Yeah, the first book right there, the red one, right? The first book, yeah, right there. Now, the point that I'm making to you is that whereas a child being misguided or miseducated is certainly damaging, but you can accept the excuse from the child, but not from the teacher. Why? Because they have to study basic grammar, basic arithmetic to even qualify to teach in the first place. So you already know when they don't make those explanations and corrections, they're compromised. Or they're just in partnership with the corruption. Either way, they're disqualified. Now, point of it is the duty and responsibility of those who know to tell the truth and to fix this problem. And logically, anybody that's allegedly conscious already knows this, no different than you know, like your brother, like you said, you're a barber, right? My family's barbers. Now, you already know, like a lot of the barbers today may learn the skills, but many of them don't have a doctorate, meaning they don't know hair follicles, they don't know hair structure, bone structure, germicides, etc., the crown of the head, the different textures of hair, and stuff like that. Most of them just do an apprenticeship and learn styles. Like in the old school, you actually had to know all the anatomy of the body, just like a doctor, actually. And even when you see the strike pole, it actually, because early, barbers also did what is called bloodletting. You know, yes, and so they knew the structure of the body. Now I know, like my father, when I was growing up, we had to study books on the body structure, and we had to do tests, and the tests basically that you had to take had nothing to do immediately with cutting hair. Everything had to do with the anatomy of the body, bone structure, hair structure, germicides, etc., cleanliness, and all these things like this. And half of these barbers today don't have none of those skills. They just know how to style, if you get the point. You had strapped a razor on a belt, and you know me, yes. You know, I remember the old with pearl handled razors, you know, and it was Solingen, that was one of the names. And the razors were made in Germany, and it was the finest steel. You know, and things cost a fortune. You know, you strap that thing, and you soft and slick. You know, yeah. So he was trained in all that. He was trained in bone structure, muscle structure, massage, facials, different solutions, natural and other, lemons, stuff like that, different things for purification, eating the skin, you know, pulling out back aches and stuff like that, a whole bunch of stuff. That was just part of barbering. You don't even see none of that anymore. But anyway, so it's the same thing. So just like even in, you know, construction, you know, where your standard structures with studs, whether you're using metal studs or wood studs, in your general construction, you have 16 on center. You're dealing with plumbs and levels, stuff like that. Birds nesting, if you're doing hip roofs, different, you know, structural frames. The same way another carpenter can come behind another carpenter and look for certain things. Likewise, in fundamental education, a teacher that's teaching in this area would have a basic degree in arithmetic and math, even if they're not mastering that. Likewise, they would have basic degrees in English and in the language. No different than if you're a teacher and someone has a substitute for you, they may not specialize where you are, but all the basics they have to know to even get their degrees in the first place. So for any teacher to maintain that these children they're teaching are black children are absolutely compromised because they absolutely know better. Just because they've been practicing that does not justify them. Are we clear? Same thing with teachers, you know, that are teaching these children that know about the Act of Congress, 1871, and will sit around and talk about racism rather than talk about the Acts of Congress, 1871, where they institutionalized forced servitude that they call slavery, which is the foundation of our economic problems to the day, and then don't talk about it. And then when this information is brought up, act like it's some Moorish thing that they don't know nothing about. They know every damn thing about it. They're compromised. You know, and so these are just fundamentals with any scholar, or any scholarship, with, you know, but the masses are so naive the way they've been trained, they think because people don't speak about these things openly that they have no knowledge of them. They have been beneficiaries of this corruption. Same thing with the priesthood. So again, consciousness, as we call it, would be people knowing that this paradigm of operation exists. So just because the Europeans went around calling themselves white people, they know they're not white people. They know that that was set up with the Knights of Columbus Ku Klux Klan oath in 1853 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, with the Knights of Columbus and the Ku Klux Klan oath in 1863, same in Chicago. And that's out of the Whig-a-mole party when the Europeans under Horace Greeley start calling themselves white people. Was a political move, has nothing to do with complexion, has everything to do with status and then stealing your birthright. Now, so all Masons, all Illuminati, all Eastern Stars, Daughters of the American Revolution, Thule Society, Daughters of Isis, Knights of Columbus, Templars, all of them know this stuff. You know, but they don't speak publicly because it's to their political advantage and not to yours. So even like in our conversation earlier, and this is back to Tamara, you know, consciousness comes in degrees. That's why I always say Islam comes in degrees. However, there's a certain basis upon which, when you're called conscious, that you must reach. No different than, you know, like if anybody is brought into any secret society, there are certain degrees that you're given that qualify you for journeyman or beginner or neophyte, which means you got to reach a certain degree to even be accepted. So basic, you want to know these basic things. It ain't no such thing as a journeyman not knowing these things. We're not saying everybody studies diligently. No different than you see a lot of people will go to schools, they'll study to pass a test and then forget the nature of it because they only studied to pass a test, but they've been exposed. So when the information comes up, they recognize it. I mean, there is no such thing of anybody in any secret society in the Western Hemisphere that don't know that the Maghrib is Morocco, the most extreme West, and that does not know that the Europeans are Europeans. They're not Americans. They're foreign occupiers under the Spanish Inquisition, occupying a land and a people that is not their own. The only people that forgot that is the people who've been trained by them, who pretend that they're white Americans and this ridiculous stuff, and forget that they're the Americans. And then teach it to their children, get lost in the bowl, and because no one speaks openly, think that other people don't know this. That's where our problem is. Again, and so these dynamics of linguistic semantics was set up for that mind control. In other words, where you're supposed to be educated in this column, and this can go on and on, so you're also dealing with, as an example, right? Likewise. Now that's it. That's what's in operation. So when you're doing any writs, right? Particularly, see, when you start to do writs, you're indicating to the world that you're now competent. Now, understanding that they set up the Global Estate Trust after the Conquest of the Moors, that's the whole politics of the entire world. You can't serve two masters. You can't have a foot here, and then make an argument and have standing. This is embodied in the nature of the Dred Scott case, as an example, which is your most important slave case ever to come before the Supreme Courts of the United States. Now, so in the Dred Scott case, phony scholars or compromised scholars will start talking racism and colors. That's the training. That's the mind control. But a true scholar knows that that person is an operative, particularly if he looks like me and you. If he's a European, a Kyklos, Camellia, Kaiko's Kukos clan is expected because that's their political position, not that they don't know better. That's their political agenda, all right? But if it's an Asiatic, he's a COINTELPERO. No excuses for him, COINTELPERO. Are we clear? People who can't read or don't know the history will make excuses for them. They never said it, so I don't think he knows. You're naive. You know, and we've got to get our people past this degree of naivety that aids in to keep burying the next generation, which is what's been going on. Wow. You know, and so again, this is the point, and I'm emphasizing this.
Yeah.
So when I was looking over your ribs, because particularly because the thing came to my mind because I know that you all been having classes on ribs.
Right.
So in general, everything's good. Those are the two major flaws I saw immediately. And both of which can neutralize it. Can neutralize. So if you just keep that in mind and be aware of that. And remember, no abbreviations. Stop the abbreviations. You know, so I can't emphasize that enough. No abbreviations. Always make reference to the state republic or state commonwealth. And it's only four commonwealths operating under the jurisdiction of a legitimate republic. And all the rest are republics. Refer to them. And so as soon as we'll say things like state of Delaware, you're in the middle of the state. You're under the post jurisdiction. So now if you're trying to argue against the IRS or something like that, they're taking the position that you can't be serving the Pope and then be a free man. You know, so when they're talking about either the common law or the recognition of the common law, therefore your language must be into the common law language or must be constitutional. As an example, when Noam Crowley says, you know, we collectively as a people need to stop practicing those names and principles that delude to slavery. That's actually what he's saying. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot speak colored language and then be allodial. And you can't mix them.
Gotta be 100% allodial.
This is where the diligence comes in. And this is again where we carefully remind people to restore and restock your libraries with quality dictionaries, plural. American Heritage Dictionary on English Language, important one. Etymological Dictionary on English Language, etc. Older Oxford, etc., which you already know. These are fundamental tools. And understanding that it's upon you to teach your children, not expecting the Romans to do it. Don't complain about them not doing it. What made you expect them to do it? Other than you being lazy or irresponsible. You know, like the man who enslaved you going to give you the keys to your liberation. It's illogical for you to even think that. Now, the deal of it is, in the nature of their political operations, the nature of them politically undermining the republic is that they have to set up what is called a shadow or substitute government or an imposter operation to disguise their continued activity of impersonating government. That's what the U.S. democracy is. Absolutely what it is. Not guessing, not semantic. That's exactly what it is. You know, like you go into that Constitution and say, nothing about democracy. Article 4, Section 4 deals with the Republic. Now, logically, when people present this democracy argument, and it's clearly not in the Constitution, and people perpetrate that, particularly teachers, you already know they're compromised. And others who agree to it, you tell they ain't reading. You get the point. So that's my reference into the RIP as I'm looking at them on the immediate tip. And so the thing that came to my mind is with you sending that, and of course, we've seen that also earlier, because I think that's the second time you sent for that to be looked at. You said one before.
That was me. That's me.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just saying it's still choice. But they're still looking at it. The point that I'm making is that I noticed immediately. And so I was thinking in my mind whether or not everyone else studying with your class is aware of that. So make sure that everyone's aware of that.
We press to be 100% colonial, not only in your writing, but in your communication.
So this is the proper person principle. So the proper person principle also deals with the presentment of self in proprio persona. So when you're talking about in solo proprio, in your own hand, in your own land, and in proprio persona, you're saying to the world that you're not here. And even when you nationalize, you're dealing with what? Restoration of constitutional platform. And so this is why when you step over here, you got the diversity instrument called the nationality card. And so immediately now all your communications would be from a consular venue, which is the proper venue for diversity of nationality. But this is also even, and this is redundant, with the explosion of consciousness in relationship to the consular platform that we presented for the last couple of years, where you've seen trolls in opposition, what it has done is uncovered a lot of roaches that otherwise you may not have known existed amongst you, because it forces people to take a position. But people's eagerness to stop the liberation of the people, sometimes in their eagerness, they don't recognize that they just expose themselves.
It's fine.
If you understand. And as time passes, it will become more apparent. So you'll also notice in the future, and in the near future, a lot of this stuff playing itself out, because a lot of people stepped out too fast to critique it. And once it's out there,
can't pull it back.
Yes. You get the whole point. But yeah, like I told you, we got a lot of sleepers amongst us. And again, as people become more conscious, see, our deal and our responsibility is making sure, like him, this generation doesn't have to go through the BS and all of this hard studying that you're going through to purge yourself, that they're already purged from the door, that you don't allow them to get steep in that native programming, because you give them the keys that they need at an earlier age.
Islam.
So whereas at his age, as an example, he may not be as immediately as interested because he's not too steeped yet in the obligatory operations of job, 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 job. You know, at the same time, he's not as compromised. So certain things in relationship to estates, property, foreclosures, robbery of estate, gentrification, Trail of Tears, now called gentrification, would not be part of his total experience that he's on his way, but so his interest, because he ain't hit that way yet, though he's a target. So he may not take this as serious as you would that been hit, meaning you've been hooked, so you got motivation. The deal is to protect him before he gets there. Meaning that show him the gloves early. So when he goes down the alley, he's coming out the other end with his lunch.
That's right.
You get the point. He took my lunch and stuff. You know, and he said, what happened. You know, so we want to make sure that doesn't happen to them. But you have to present it in such a way that they're interested, that it's not scooped up. And this is back to the dog motto must be dismissed. And you must just tell the truth and don't apologize for the truth. And then give them reference points. Give them the tools they need. So instead of buying $150 sneaks, you buy the $50 sneaks, take the other $100 and buy them some books. And do some research. Don't just go buy something that you just see on the shelf. Go to old bookstores and start getting them older books. Yeah, you want to spend a little bit of finance, but it'll be a scholar in short order. And then once they start getting motivated, you know, they get kind of get self-motivated after they start realizing that they've been played. You know, because it doesn't take long for a person, you know, once they get over their emotional pride, you know, their self-pride, and thought you were spiritual, thought you knew what was up, thought you had degrees and education, and you've been played. You know, so when people get over their ego and their little bit of vanity and a little bit of clubism, you know, protecting the club image that you belong to, and start really seeing that the masses are deeply asleep and been deeply played, they will be self-motivated to fix this thing. So again, without being redundant, that's very important. So no abbreviations, so write that down. Make sure everybody around you do the same thing. Always talk about the living man or woman doing business under the corporate operations. So like if you're talking, like say for instance, if you get an instrument from the Inquisition operators, you know, of the criminal cabal called the IRS, you wouldn't talk to the IRS. You'd talk to a man or woman that communicated with you doing business as foreign agent for the foreign, for-profit, criminal, corporate operations of the Internal Revenue Service, unlawfully operating on the land. Now the other deal, and that's how you would talk, and so the deal is, even in our language of communication, we gotta get back into the knowledgeable habit of not avoiding lengthy structured statements or lengthy structured sentences. Because what you want to do when you're communicating with them is close all doors. They operate from this perspective. Any right that you don't claim or don't exercise, their position is you've abandoned it. And when you're looking at foreclosures, and this is redundant, this is why it's important, they're all listed as abandonments because they're talking about estates and they're talking about rights. And this is back to the issue of the average person not aware that they assign themselves as FOFR is under feudal law. Now, trustee is, the role is pretty much the same. But like say trustee, right? And the feudal law, that would be a FOFR. Now, so when they do debt pledges or mortgages, they sign themselves as your FOFR. And so under the feudal law, see, under the Republic, your right of property and estate is intact and recognized. Under the U.S. democracy or feudal law, it is absolutely the opposite. They do not recognize your right to your property. So everything under U.S. democracy is hypothecated automatically. So any instruments that are issued to you, like mortgages and loans like that, is already rooted in fraud. So if you're transacting any business under the United States Corporation Company, whatever you think that you're buying, you immediately convert it and take it into an allodial trust. Failure to do so, their consideration is that you've abandoned it. This is the basis upon which all foreclosures are made. Is that simple enough for you? That, in other words, if you understand, it is really that simple. So remember, status and estate are equals. And so any effort that you put forth in your labor is still your own. That the instruments that are given or transferred with you under the private commercial paper that you refer to as fiat is for bookkeeping purposes only. It is not money. Don't call it money. Don't refer to it as money. At that time, you stepped out of this and stepped over here. Now you've accepted the liability. This is again why we emphasize to change your language. And I think a lot of times people think that we're making too much of a semantic argument when the real deal of this, you can't serve two masters in this chess game because they're not playing. They're in the business of stealing people's estates. And so we emphasize to you and cannot emphasize enough while we say to you, change your language. But be aware of why you're changing your language. Are we clear? That's why we give you history. That's it. Okay? Are we clear? So again, when you go and you start looking at the legal arguments that are made by persons doing business under corporate states, start paying attention to how they structure the letters. And of course, this is also with your knowledge and comprehension that person means corporation unless otherwise stated. So even when you use the word person, you don't use people or natural person to make it specific. Because if it's just person, it means corporation. You know, so when you know these things, you know, you start inculcating them into your language, into your communications. You make that a part of your language. Also, when you're dealing with them and they recognize that your language has changed, they have a tendency whether or not to take you serious. And a lot of times, those little semantic facts and innuendos has much to do with sometimes what confuses people, where certain people may communicate with them, get results, and another person comes back and they assume that they're making a conscious argument and their successes are not there. And then, of course, you also have the positions where the Romans also want to keep people, as you might say, cognate, or faithful in the systems. And so they allow certain flybys because they have to keep faith in the system. Are we clear? However, it is not the norm. Are we clear?
All right.
So that's what I have to say about the writs. All right, so if you keep those things in mind and clean that up, everything else you got is cool. So remember, one of the keys that Rome does, as an example, say this is the corporate entity, right? So what they call the LLC. And they'll write you and promote the linguistic formats of the state of New York versus Joe Bibelfester, as an example. And the people respond, well, the state of New York sent me a letter telling me I got a blah, 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 blah. You just fell for it. Because the state of New York can't talk. It's an artificial entity constructed on paper that has owners. You better find out who their owners are. The operators and talk to them. And it was, this is what they do. Like, say, for instance, like this is a corporation, right? So this is a corporation, and they do like this. Hulk! Right?
Yeah.
And then
the corporation over there, you start cussing him out. I'm the one that did it. It's exactly the same thing.
Right. Well, this book right here, hook me.
You know, this thing is inanimate.
Right.
And for some strange reason, it's difficult to get people to recognize that which is animated versus that which is inanimate.
So the Europeans present to these people an inanimate corporate entity constructed on paper that has succession principle for bookkeeping for resources stolen. And the people start arguing, it's like somebody arguing with the Sears building. Yeah, Kmart, Walmart.
Yeah, I brought this TV down to Kmart and stuff, and the thing don't work. So we're going to go down there and walk around the Kmart building 2 o'clock in the morning and protest, cussing the Kmart building out.
It's no different than that. they're wasting their time. They were to find out who the CEO is or the manager of that building and talk to that being. Because the building ain't viable. You know, and this is where they train people into the personification of corporate entities. And we have adopted into it, and our language reflects that socialization. Consciousness would indicate that you've outgrown that, and you're no longer a boy or girl, and you address things accordingly. All right? So anyway, thank you all for coming out to the House of Reawakening Minds. Trust that we've done some good. Trust that we've done some good. And due to the training running, you know, for the, so I'm going to have to roll, so I'll miss the training again.
Once again, we thank you, Grand Sheik, National Grand Sheik, Tarik Bey, for coming out to the House of the Awakened Mind as we strive to be a holistic center for spiritual grounding, free thought, self-discovery, and more science, an awakening experience for all ages. We do have some upcoming events tomorrow, August the 18th, at 5 p.m. to 9 p.m., as Grand Sheik talked about. We have vocabulary for brick writing class with Brother Aaron L. That will be tomorrow, August the 18th at 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. You will have the opportunity to go over your writs that you have in place and some things that you will need to get your language in perspective. We also have August the 24th, we have Father Hannibal Bey, who will deal again with the adept science, going to the next level in your warrior science knowledge. Keep in mind, we have new talk, learn etymology. This is an 8-hour power-packed class on September the 22nd, 2018, which is Brother Abdullah L. Talib Mosey Bey will be the teacher for that day. You can sign up online through the Eventbrite link. Online will be 25 notes, and in classroom will be 35 notes. So once again, we thank you for coming out and tuning in each and every Friday to House of Reawakening Minds. Islam.